group hug. Please come and join me on the sofa. Today, I'm really delighted to welcome Tom Hall, who is Global Head of Philanthropy at UBS. How are you, Tom?
I'm great. Lovely to be here.
Give us a download on what you do. I mean, probably even day to day, or the services that you have for clients at UBS.
Yeah, so as you said, I'm Global Head of Philanthropy Services at UBS, which some people might think is a strange role for a big global bank to have. But for us, it makes complete sense, actually. We recently just announced our new purpose as a business, and the whole business is about reimagining the power of finance and connecting people for a better world. And in a discreet way, that's what I do in my day job. We've got 75 people globally who support our clients to maximize the impact of every dollar, pound, Swiss franc that they invest in wanting to improve the world and wanting to solve the pressing social and environmental problems that the world's facing. And in simple terms, what we do is we offer really great advice. So what does good philanthropy look like? Not all philanthropy is equal, actually. You can cause harm with poorly implemented philanthropy. I saw firsthand mosquito nets being used for fishing that were impregnated with DEET that poisoned the lake, poisoned the fish, and even the people who ate the fish, because you know they didn't have a good distribution strategy behind them. You can also waste your money if you don't get it right. Or the opportunity cost of not investing philanthropy right can mean you don't have as much impact as you potentially could have had. We have really, I would say, engaging insight experiences, so events, lots of webinars. Obviously, these days, we used to do trips to places like Liberia and Nepal, maybe take 10 to 12 families, just to see high quality strategic philanthropy in action. And then I would say what's really quite unique to UBS is we don't just talk about it. We don't just have great events where clients connect with peers, which is really important. We also have an execution capacity where we can help our clients implement their philanthropy strategies. And we do that through our own network of philanthropic vehicles, donor advice funds in particular, and through the UBS Optimus Foundation, which is really not a foundation in a traditional sense. It's more like a private equity style approach to highly effective, evidence-based, scalable solutions to some of the pressing social and environmental problems that our clients are passionate about. And we often use the Sustainable Development Goals as a framework for talking about, you know, the kinds of problems that we want to support our clients to address.
Fantastic. And I'd just like to say to viewers, if you enjoy this session, please press the thumbs up and subscribe, and we'll let you know about other sessions that are coming up. So, Tom, can you define philanthropy for me? Because I'm sometimes feel like in wealth management and the collective worlds that attach to it, that the general public may not exactly understand the terms that we use. So just be interesting to get your definition of it.
Yeah, well, absolutely. So philanthropy itself is coming from a Greek word, which means love of people. So in that real sense, it's about trying to use one's resources to improve the human condition, enable people to live their life to the full. And in that sense, it's not really changed in thousands of years. I think what's emerged over the last 20-25 years is just an exponential growth in philanthropy. I mean, I've seen this and been the beneficiary of it really in my career, having spent 16-17 years initially in the nonprofit world and now for the last 8 years at UBS. And what we've seen is exponential wealth creation. So many of the people I've been fortunate enough to work with, I've advised maybe 1,600-1,700 families and clients and their families in my time at UBS alone. Is people with a great deal more wealth than they expected, particularly entrepreneurial new wealth, and really asking the question, what's my wealth for? You know, once you've looked after yourself and your family, you end up with a huge amount of resources that we at UBS often say will go into a kind of a legacy bucket. You really resources I'm going to use to try and, you know, address the issues that I'm really passionate about. And at its heart, that's what philanthropy is. It's trying to use your resources to make the world a better place. The reality is, though, as I said earlier, that not all philanthropy is good and effective. So it's not enough, actually, to have good intentions. You also have to have good strategy. And at its heart, that's what me and my team do.
And what kind of size of money would people need to have? Do they need to be a UBS client, or can they just come to you for philanthropy? And if they do, what general size or average size of client or pots of money are you dealing with to implement these strategies?
Well, obviously, UBS is a wealth manager. So me and my team are here to serve clients who are potential clients of a wealth management service like UBS, which, you know, we have different segments that we serve. So that might start at you know, clients with, you know, invested assets of 2 million up. right through to the business. And I work with all of them. And actually, what's really important is that it's personal to them. So if somebody, and interestingly, I remember early on in my career, I met my first billionaire and they were giving away 50 grand a year. And I've worked with people who are more, you know, of more modest means, obviously still wealthy in the grand scheme of things, who might give away, you know, half of their 10 million. And I think it's really about attitude as much as it is about wealth profile. But what's true for every single philanthropist is that no one has sufficient resources on their own or even in totality to solve a single problem. So the fundamental facts are that we have to use our philanthropic resources really strategically and intentionally if we want to try and address the issues that we're passionate about, whether that's locally, nationally, or globally.
And is philanthropy timeless in terms of topics? I mean, is it always the same actions that really need to be addressed, or has, for instance, this new sustainability theme change the kind of things you're talking about? What's the situation now?
Well, I'd like to think that it's not timeless in the sense that really, if you're intentional and you understand the problem that you're trying to solve and you find a good strategy to address that particular issue, you can actually literally catalyze solutions to problems. So, you know, take, for example, something like polio. In 1988, there were, you know, almost 400,000 cases globally. A philanthropic movement, which often gets associated with the Gates Foundation, but actually it was a group of other philanthropists who started it, then Gates got involved and lots of other governments, have essentially invested in a single strategy around vaccines, incidentally, that has ultimately eradicated polio, except from two very small war-torn parts of the world. My hope and belief is that we can apply that similar approach to lots of different problems so that we aren't constantly trying to address the same issues. And in fact, I think that's been one of the issues in philanthropy or in the charity sector overall, is that sometimes people can feel a little bit disillusioned. They're like, well, I feel like I was kind of funding Ethiopian famines in Live Aid in 1985, and the problem doesn't seem to have changed at all. So is it touching the sides? Is it having an impact? And I think what's changed within this whole sustainability discussion is really you've got two things. One is we've got the Sustainable Development Goals. So we have a baseline. We actually really know how bad are a whole load of problems, from social to environmental issues. What size are they? And how are we going to make progress? And the only way we're going to make progress is if we invest large sums of capital, both philanthropic capital at the innovation end, trying to test, find new, more efficient, more effective ways of addressing those problems, and then investment capital to scale it up at scale, offering investors a market risk-adjusted return. So in some senses, I think what you're seeing is this alignment in goals with the same ultimate vision, which is building a sustainable world, you know, building out our low carbon future, enabling the billion people who don't have access to healthcare to actually be able to go and see a doctor. And, you know, things like COVID and the pandemic, we see how vulnerable we all are when these issues aren't addressed. When people don't have access to things like basic healthcare, then we could all be affected. So actually working together and seeing the roles different types of capital can play in really focusing on addressing problems is part of, I think, all of financial services reimagining the power of investment over the next 10 years.
So could you give me an example just to illustrate to viewers perhaps a project or something you've admired in this sector that you could highlight?
Yeah, sure. So actually last year, the height of the COVID pandemic, we've been operating now for 20 years, so we've got good networks, a good platform, lots of partners all over the world. We launched a COVID response fund that raised 15 million from our clients globally in 3 weeks, which UBS matched dollar for dollar. So it was $30 million invested into lots of different interventions, primarily in some of the most vulnerable communities in the world where they don't have access to basic things like healthcare. And the knock-on effect, of course, of COVID, as we all felt, I've got four children, so it was very real in my household, the educational side, right? And again, you know, education is so important for long-term human potential and enabling people to live their lives to the full and grow economies. So we knew immediately that there would be an issue with education after COVID as well. So our COVID response fund was invested in both the health and into the education side. And one of the education partners we funded is almost a classic case study of what I was just describing, which is an innovation that had all the recipe to try and get to scale. And we'd been funding them for about 5 years. We started with a $200,000 initial test. And their idea was that they could teach children in countries like Liberia much more efficiently, much more cost efficiently, because they think they had literacy rates at the time on average of 15%. So public money, essentially $100 per child per year being completely wasted. And this organization Rising, amongst another of others that we tested, proved that they could actually teach children twice as fast as in government schools, so for less money. So they had a randomized control trial, the same as when you have a clinical trial for the vaccines, really great evidence that they were effective. And they were starting to scale up before the pandemic in lots of different ways. One was a private school model, so people were paying for it themselves. Others was directly funded by government. Others were in quite complex public-private partnerships. And the fourth was in this thing called outcomes purchasing, which is a big paradigm shift where governments, instead of paying and hoping things work, actually only pay when it's worked and it's been evidenced by a third party. So it's a big shift in actually how public money can be spent, which is very exciting for philanthropy. Anyway, cut long story short, Rising were serving about 100,000 children at the beginning of the pandemic. We gave them an emergency response grant to say, look, do something to reach children who are now not able to go to school because of COVID. They decided to take their curriculum onto the radio because, of course, again, no iPads like my children were fortunate enough to be able to use at school. They had to go analog with a radio-based curriculum, which was translated into 12 different languages, rolled out to 25 countries, and 15 million children benefited from it in last year, all off kind of leveraging that slow, steady approach of using philanthropic capital to build more efficient, more effective, more scalable ways to bring high quality education in that context to as many people as possible.
Fascinating. So let's, picking up on your theme there of children, let's have a look at succession in philanthropy and how those two can snap together, or in fact are together, to help the handing over of money, or help generations be together with wealth.
Absolutely. And what we find is that conversation is often in lockstep. And it's really part of what we call our wealth way, which is that idea of liquidity, how much do I need to live on today? Longevity, how much do I need for the future? And then legacy, which is ultimately, how much am I leaving for my family? And what am I going to dedicate to the things that I'm passionate about? And I think one of the things that I've noticed, and certainly in the families I've advised, and I do think there's a degree of a split here between first generation wealth creation and obviously second, third, fourth generation money. In that first generation space, I think often the values and the drive that created an entrepreneur came through from jeopardy, from risk, from fear of failure. And there is a real concern that if too much wealth transfer is handed on to the next generation, it could take away that very drive, that very essence of what made them successful. So I think these are very personal discussions. And you see from things like the Giving Pledge that many of the wealthiest families are dedicating actually pretty large proportions of their overall wealth to the make the world a better place bucket, the legacy bucket, whether that's philanthropy or forms of impact investing is evolving, but it's not necessarily for the family. So within that, you can often have what is a really important conversation with the children, explaining why those decisions have been made, but also what their role is in stewarding those family resources that have been dedicated to make the world a better place. And we do that actively. In fact, on Thursday, I've got the first in a series of workshops with a family, and mum, dad, all the children, grown-up children, all designing together what their philanthropic strategy is going to be, how they're going to use the resources, really trying to get the buy-in between them, and it be a bonding experience as well, and one that can be used to communicate family values and the things that are most important to that family, even after the initial kind of wealth generator has passed on. And I think the families who do that really well I think, end up stronger as a result.
I agree. Yes, I guess they iron through some values and issues. In terms of impact investing, is impact investing and philanthropy the same thing? Can you give us your breakdown?
No, it's not the same thing. And I think it's important to distinguish how it's different. So earlier I said that philanthropy is about, you know, the love of people. And I think the way we'd like to think about it is it's almost there's a continuum of capital. Now, arguably, all investment has an impact, right? You just don't necessarily know it or measure it. So if you start at the kind of traditional end of investing, the vast majority, particularly of discretionary investments, and UBS announced that all of its kind of standard discretionary investments will be sustainable as a default going forward, you're starting to try and overlay a form of impact measurement on your investing there. You're measuring its sustainability, if you like. So particularly on the carbon side, or on other environmental footprint, or things like ESG factors, which we know have an impact on the sustainability, the viability of a company to be profitable into the long term. With sustainable investing and ESG investing, though, you're not necessarily measuring the direct causation of the investment that you've put in place. Impact investment is kind of the next step along a continuum which says, I'm going to invest, I still want a market risk adjusted return. So my fiduciary duty, if you like, and of course within the financial services industry, that's really important, is first and foremost, but I do want to know whether it's having a measurable impact. So for example, a good example is something like clean energy. If I put these wind turbines in, are they going to reduce the CO2e equivalent in that location? And can I measure it? And I think that's a really important point, because there is a fear and a risk that investments marketed as impact investment aren't really measuring that causation. And in fact, you could see it going the opposite way, in which case it's been falsely marketed, because you have a duty from a suitability perspective to make sure that if somebody wants an impact investment, you are able to prove the impact as well as the financial return. So that space is growing, but the causality of impact that you can measure in impact investment is not total. You can't necessarily prove out causation in each and every investment, because it's expensive and it's quite complicated. But that's where the world needs to get to. Ultimately, what we want to get to is that every investment can measure both its negative and positive impact, and ideally offer a financial return. Where philanthropy has a role to play is, again, starting at the other end of the spectrum, you've got traditional charitable giving, which is basically not really measured. It's often based on emotion. And the risk there is you just don't know what impact you're getting. A bit like the people who invest and are not measuring impact at the other end. You can be putting money into things, hoping it's working, but without measuring it, you just don't really know. Strategic philanthropy is a term that we often use to say, I'm intentionally putting my philanthropic capital, probably as a grant, into trying to maybe invest in Rising, as an example, a new innovation that I hope will prove impact and go to scale in the future. And now there's also an emerging kind of additional step on strategic philanthropy, which is a step before impact investing that we call social finance, which is using philanthropic capital, so money that's been given away, but actually not giving it as a grant, but using it as a loan or even an equity investment, but really with a view of trying to build business models that, instead of focusing first on the fiduciary duty, the financial return, are focusing first on the causality of impact. So you might be willing to take more risk, for example, in your investment. So we took an equity investment in an early child development business in South Africa that, you know, probably a PE investment house that wants a 22% return wouldn't have thought was a good deal. We thought it was a really good deal because they have a learning curriculum that's reaching children in really vulnerable communities with really high quality early child development material. And their business model is essentially a cross-subsidized one. So wealthy families who can afford to pay buy their product, and it's therefore cross-subsidized, and they give some of it for free to more vulnerable communities. So it's a kind of a scalable business model that can reach both the most vulnerable, but also, hopefully, if it goes to scale, lots of other families too. So taking an equity investment in that with philanthropic capital kind of makes sense, because it's going to deliver causal impact. It's proving that it can help children learn. But if it's successful, we'll get that philanthropic capital back to reuse to take another risk investment that's focused on really trying to drive more business models that can prove their impact.
Yeah, and that's a good thing for sure. I understand that. And what about Brexit? You've talked a lot about international impact there. So is Brexit having an impact on charities or philanthropy and giving?
I personally haven't noticed any change from Brexit. And quite honestly, I think Brexit, like for all of us, got subsumed by the pandemic. And the impact of the pandemic was really interesting. I was actually really quite proud in the sense that within weeks, when we all really didn't know what was going on and what would happen to our own families, I was being proactively contacted by so many of our clients saying, I know it's bad here in the UK or in the US, but think what it's like in Liberia, which we visited with you last year, when they have no healthcare. And they're genuine, this concern about the most vulnerable communities. And hence we did this COVID response fund that I mentioned. And actually we've seen giving increase in the pandemic in terms of people really deciding that, we are literally only as safe as the most vulnerable person in the world, and starting to think more broadly even in terms of what they want to give to. So rather than Brexit being a big change in philanthropy, I think the pandemic has been.
And was there any issue with deployment? That was one of the problems I heard from one of the, it was maybe a lawyer or an investment manager, said that deployment became an issue through COVID. Was that something you saw?
Deployment of capital. Yeah, I mean, I guess one of the challenges you have with giving into, global south and of countries that people don't visit so much is that you want to be able to do due diligence. You want to be able to go and visit things so that you can make sure that the money's being well spent. And clearly that whole infrastructure, the way that we did things 14, 15 months ago, has had to be redeveloped. And that is why partnerships are so important, and thinking about local community-led philanthropy is really important. So I think really high quality impact will only happen when it's also done in partnership with the local community. So a lot of the organizations that we recommend as a business are actually in country, and they're led by people, founded by people from that country. And in that sense, you don't have a deployment issue because you've already got relationships and partnerships with people within a network around the world that you know and like and trust. In addition, we tend to have evaluating partners that are also locally deployed who provide that local oversight. So you can create a system that moves away from a model where you need to be able to fly in, fly out to oversee the efficacy of your grant. So again, I agree some organizations were struggling with that, but I would say that that's because their system was not set up in a way that allows for real global scale and partnership building.
So finishing up, talk to us about the negative side perhaps of charities or philanthropy. So tax, regulation, problems, things that can go wrong.
Well, I think often, and particularly in the financial services industry, philanthropy gets distilled into a structural issue. So how much should I give, when, and how do I get my tax relief? And look, I like to say nobody gives for tax relief. I've yet to meet somebody who the only reason they give for tax relief in any country, because you give away a dollar or a pound, you're still foregoing half of it for spending on yourself. So if you want to spend that money on a new car, that's what you'll do. So people who are giving away their money are philanthropic at heart. Obviously, they want to give tax efficiently, because if you can double the value of your foundation by giving tax efficiently, then that makes complete sense. So planning your giving over often many years efficiently to build up your legacy pot, your foundation or philanthropic giving vehicle is sensible and smart. But I don't really think that's 5% of the conversation on philanthropy. It really is. It's the starting point. Yes, you need to think about it, but you should spend much more time and energy worried about, when I do start either giving that money away or using some of these new instruments like lending into charities or social enterprises, or even taking equity positions, using that capital to drive impact as efficiently and effectively as possible, the question we should always be asking ourselves is, how do I know it works? How am I measuring the impact? And sadly, I think what we see with a lot of the charity sector, this isn't to denigrate it, I just think it's how it's emerged, is that they often do what they've always done. And measurement of impact can be costly, And there's often drivers against spending money on those things. You know, charities are often put under a lot of pressure not to spend money on what's perceived to be overhead. Yet the reality is, you know, if you can spend 99p in the pound on a program that's on the front line, but if it's not efficacious, then that's all wasted money. So I think it's really important that we do invest in high quality measurement, that we understand whether the things that we're funding actually work. And not only do they work, are they working in the cheapest, most cost-effective way? Or could they be improved further? Because as I said before, ultimately, there's nowhere near enough philanthropy in total to grant our way out of the pressing social and environmental problems the world's facing. You know, kind of macroeconomically, we need something like $25 trillion to meet the SDG funding gap. Philanthropy currently has 2. We think it might grow to 10 in the next 10 to 15 years because there's so much wealth creation has happened. But even that is nowhere near enough, right? It's less than half of what's needed. So we have to use every philanthropic dollar highly carefully in things that work with a mindset that tries to drive it to scale. And I think that is the big risk, but also opportunity with philanthropy today.
That's great. Thank you so much. It's been a really good update. And we look forward to seeing you in better times.
Hopefully not too long away.
Thank you so much to Tom Hall, Global Head of Philanthropy at UBS. Join us on our live sessions 11:30, Tuesdays and Fridays.